Hi, I'm Andrea Mosie, and I'm excited to share our Apollo Lunar Lab here at NASA Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. From 1969 to 1972, astronauts went to the surface of the moon during six Apollo missions and brought back 382 kilograms, 842 pounds of rocks, soil, regolith, and core samples. Our job here at NASA Johnson Space Center is to take care of those samples. The picture shows our pristine sample lab, and you'll see the nitrogen-filled cabinets, and we have neoprene gloves that we use to work on those samples. But we cannot touch the samples with those gloves. We have to put on an additional glove, which is a Teflon glove. The Apollo 11 sign that you see on this cabinet is evident that each mission has specific designated cabinets. We don't mix missions during processing, and we don't mix rock types or rock generic numbers during processing. All of the tools in the cabinets are Teflon, aluminum, or stainless steel. Those are the only type of materials that we use on the samples. And this slide you will see from right to left, we'll see our Apollo curator. Dr. Ryan A. Ziegler is our Apollo sample curator. You see our curation processors, Jeremy Kent, Linda Watts, Lacey Castillo, Charis Krysher, and of course, me. Charis is working in Apollo 16 cabinet. I'm assisting her at the glove port, and Charis is doing allocations for a requested PI, which is a principal investigator. They put in their request. After the requests are approved, we find the sample that they are looking for and allocate those samples to them. This cabinet is one that has been modified for innovation. Charis will tell you what we do in another part of our facility. Take it away, Charis.
Thank you, Andrea. If you can see here, I work with Andrea and the rest of the team, and we break moon rocks for a living. You can see here I'm trying to open the vault door, which leads to the vault where we actually store the rocks when we are not actively working on them inside the lab. We take security of our rocks very seriously. And here you can see us actually working inside of the vault itself. Just like Andrea described, each of these cabinets is dedicated to a particular mission. We do not mix different rocks from different missions inside of the same cabinet, with one exception that I will tell you about in a little bit. But here you can see us running through the process that it takes in order to transfer samples from the vault to the lab, from the lab to the vault, and anywhere else. It takes two different people to verify that you are moving the correct sample to the correct place. And this is so that we can keep track of each sample and know where it is at any given time. This is our display cabinet, which is the only cabinet where we mix different rocks from different missions inside of the same cabinet. It is not a cabinet in which we work in. It's purely for display so that folks who actually visit our lab have a chance to see some of the really interesting rocks with some really funny and great stories behind them. And I'm going to go ahead and tell you about some of them right now. You can see rock 15016. This is known as Seatbelt Rock. It was picked up on Apollo 15, which was the first Apollo mission that had the rover. And the funny story is that there was a safety rule that said that the astronauts could not rove any further from the lander than they had time to walk back. And that was to make sure that they had enough oxygen so that it could get back in case anything bad happened. So they saw this rock at the end of their EVA when they were back on their way back to the lander. And they knew that they were not going to get permission to pick it up. So they feigned a problem with their seatbelt, jumped off, secured the rock, and then made it back, telling mission control that they had fixed their seatbelt after they got the rock. They had picked up the rock. And when they came back to the Lunar Receiving Laboratory, this was the only rock that had not been already identified. And when asked about it, Dave Scott laughed and said, "Oh, that's a funny story." So that's the story behind Seatbelt Rock. This is rock 61016. This is known as Big Muley, which was named after a professor of geology out at University of Texas at Austin, Dr. Bill Moldberger. And it was the largest rock that was picked up on the... And you can see here, this is a great picture that shows you exactly how big it was. It was a pretty big monster. And there's actually a video on YouTube called Big Muley, and that you can see the astronauts actually picking it up. They had to roll it up the side of their leg to get a hold of it.
The next rock, Children of the World, has a story as well. This story will be told by astronaut Gene Cernan and astronaut Harrison Jack Schmidt as they were on the surface of the moon collecting Apollo 17 samples.
Jack has picked up a very significant rock, typical of what we have here in the Valley of Torrey Glacial. It's a rock composed of many fragments of many sizes and many shapes, probably from all parts of the moon, perhaps billions of years old. But a rock of all sizes and shapes, fragments of all sizes and shapes, and even colors that have grown together and become a cohesive rock, outlasting the nature of space, sort of living together in a very coherent, very peaceful manner. When we return this rock, or some of the others like it, to Houston, we'd like to share a piece of this rock with so many of the countries throughout the world. We hope that this will be a symbol of what our feelings are, what the feelings of the Apollo program are, and a symbol of mankind that we can live in peace and harmony in the future. A portion of a rock will be sent to a representative agency or museum in each of the countries represented by the young people in Houston today. And we hope that that rock and the students themselves will carry with them our good wishes, not only for the new year coming up, but also for themselves, their countries, and all mankind in the future. Put that in the big bag, you know, in the big bag.
Roger. We salute you, promise of the future. We thank you for your sentiments and your interest.
And that's exactly what happened. 50 years ago during the Apollo missions, they decided to give these as gifts, and the Children of the World rock right now is in states all around the United States and countries all around the world. It's the gift that keeps on giving. That's awesome. So to hear more about what we do, I'm going to introduce you to Juliana, and she will tell you more of our story. Take it away, Juliana.
Hi, everybody. My name is Juliane Gross, and I am the deputy curator of the Apollo sample collection here at NASA Johnson Space Center. And I'm also a professor of planetary sciences at Rutgers University in New Jersey. In this slide here, you can see me on the right with Charis in the middle and Andrea on the left in front of the Apollo 17 core sample glove box. So when the astronauts brought back samples about 50 years ago, NASA had the good foresight to keep some of these samples unopened because they knew that the technology would evolve with time, and they wanted to keep a few of the moon rocks safe and undisturbed for the next generation of lunar scientists to study. And now, almost 50 years later, this future vision of NASA has become our reality today with the so-called ANGSA program, which stands for Apollo Next Generation Sample Analysis. And Charis, Andrea, and myself, we were the three women who actually got to open one of these never opened before Apollo samples last year for the ANGSA program. All right, as you can see in this image, we were, and we still are, super excited that after 50 years, we got to open this very special sample that no one had ever seen and looked at before. So this sample gets to be studied first by a few scientists that were selected by NASA to learn more about the moon with new technologies and higher precisions to get better data. So this Apollo 17 ANGSA sample is what we call a core sample. And that means the astronauts basically took a hollow tube and hammered it into the ground, and the hollow part of the tube filled with rocks and soil. And that way, we can look at different layers on the moon that might exist underneath the surface that we can't otherwise see. So on the left side, you can see the core, what it looked like after we opened it and pushed it out of its tube. You can see it looks a little rough, but that's because we had to scrape off a millimeter of coating because it got mixed when we pushed the core out of the tube. And so we couldn't really see the undisturbed sample underneath, and we had to remove it. Now, the right side of the core is the lunar surface, and the left side of the core, that represents 22 centimeters of depth going into the lunar ground. So that's what the lunar surface looks, 22 centimeters underneath it. So what we do then, once we open the sample, we take the core apart bit by bit, and we call that dissecting, to see different colors, to find little pieces of rocks, and discover potential layers. So if you look at the bottom right image, at the right side of the core, you can see that the beginning of the core is a lot darker. And now remember, that is where the lunar surface used to be. And so the moon's surface is a little bit darker than the rocks and soil underneath the surface. So all of this will give us information about the area where the sample comes from and how the moon formed and evolved over time. All right, but before we actually open the core sample, we X-rayed the core with a new technology that is called X-ray computed tomography, or short CT scanning. And this technology didn't quite exist like this 50 years ago. And CT scanning today is normally used on us humans to take 3D pictures of the inside of our bodies in medicine, like taking a picture of your brain without actually cutting us open. And now we can use this technology to see what lunar rocks and core tubes look like on the inside without opening them or breaking the rocks. So in this image here, you can see at the bottom a picture of the core that was taken in 1974 with an X-ray machine similar to that what doctors use today to take X-ray images if you break a bone. And above that is a CT image of the same core that we took last year. And you can see how much better that picture is, how much more clear it is. So this is an example of how technology evolves over time. This is exactly why NASA had the foresight to keep some of these samples safe and unopened so that we, as the next generation of lunar scientists, can now use this technology and learn more things and new things about the moon. So this new technology can also help us identify the inside structure of rocks. And so this teeny tiny rock that you can see here in this image on the right side, we have taken with the CT scanner to see the inside of this little rock without actually breaking it. And the white stripes that you can see here, these are minerals that are called ilmenite, and that tells us a lot about the chemistry of the moon.